phone number for.
Who's a man of the community? Bring the change we need to see. Standing up for you and me.
When time go round, you will really see who for you and I times the reality. So please think twice when you choose to give a seat. Moving forward, we gon' need stability. Moving forward, we gon' need transparency. Cause everything you do, the people gon' need to see what you're doing in all the work you're putting in.
Let your yes be a yes and your no be a no.
At SXM, we're taking travel and tourism to new heights. Here we boast spacious check-in areas, 10 passport control points, comfortable departure lounges, and an exciting new airport mall. Finally, there's an airport in the Caribbean that takes your travel plans as seriously as you do. Princess Juliana International Airport. The experience will move you.
It's time to promote, so come out and vote. We not waste no time, we not make no joke. We voting for URSM, Juliana Rolex Jr. Candidate number 9, hard time but he come to shine.
Welcome to what we call the Late Night Show, and of course, it is all about what is happening on the lovely island of St. Martin. I am at the lovely Mullet Bay area where construction has started for nothing, absolutely nothing. It's still Mullet Bay. Anything? No workmen? Anyway, you know, there's so much things that's happening that I have to put things into perspective so that I make sure that, you know, people get an idea of the madness that is going around in social media and also in actual news. First, there is this rumor going around that, you know, you're not allowed to put any political material, paraphernalia, on your property or on your business or on your vehicle. And let me say this in the nicest way possible.
Bullshit! Bullshit!
If you get your own stuff, so for example, if you're a taxi driver or a bus driver or a tour operator and you get a license from the government, right? Does the government buy your vehicle? Or do you get a vehicle and then obtain a license? Or sometimes you get a license and you don't have a bus or a taxi, and that's a different show. But anyway, you have a license, but that doesn't mean that the government pays for your vehicle. So what you put on your vehicle, just like the illegal tint that you put, is what you put. So you can rock any flag, red, green, yellow, maroon, teal, black, doesn't matter. You could put a picture of yourself on your vehicle and it's yours. You don't have to worry about any consequences, because I was sent a video of the political police going around harassing candidates, going like, you can't do that. That's illegal. You can't put things on public businesses. What? You mean the same business that you pay taxes for? You can't put anything on the property you renting? Does that make any sense to you? There are guidelines that was made by the Minister of General Affairs and the Minister of Justice, and all the guidelines were sent to every political party. Now, if the political police stop being political police or stop trying to act like the leader of a party, then they would have received the guideline and know that it is allowed to put the paraphernalia, the promotional material of any political party, anywhere you want, so long it doesn't obstruct traffic or distract persons while driving, or basically do it illegally. So political parties are not allowed to just go on somebody's yard, stick up a poster there quick, and then run away and hope that the person doesn't notice, before they take it down. No, they have to ask permission. And yes, they can charge for it, or they could just do it for free. It's up to them. You know why? Because it's their property. Haha. So, that rumor, debunk. Next, I don't know what's going on, because these political parties are getting so desperate that the same media that they wanted to control last year, they're running to now to do interviews. I said now. Anyway, they're running to do interviews and to speak to people and to talk to the wonderful viewers of these, media people. But at the same time, they're not invited to come to the Council of Ministers press briefing since they took office. Now, of course, I have an example, and I've promised myself for a long time that I wasn't going to highlight this jackass Mr. Brown anymore. But the way that Mr. Brown was abused by two ministers that don't want him to come to the Council of Ministers press briefing, but he came to your ministers' meet and greet of Minister Doran, and Minister Atwell Irion and Minister Doran basically took over the whole life of Mr. Brown and did a whole reporting back and forth. And I said to myself, so we just gonna act like they don't want him to come to press briefings, but now he's the press. Now he's the actual reporter, but you don't recognize him officially. No, I'm the last person to defend Mr. Brown, but right is right, wrong is wrong. So we gotta roll a clip because I need you to see the hypocrisy.
Let's see, bro. I hear the camera out of here.
You see?
Hold on.
We're live already?
You don't trust me, man.
We're live already?
I know, Mr. Brown. I know.
Go lad.
We are here live, people.
You live for real?
Yeah.
You're going to make people laugh and we can't do that?
We are here live, people.
We don't do it right.
The reporter, Mr. Brown, and his sidekick, Mr. Arthur Irion, candidate number 3 on the National Alliance page. We are here at the event from Minister of Romney Doran Egbert, number 2 on the National Line slate. Mr. Brown, you enjoying yourself at a meet and greet?
Wonderful. This is the garden, the second biggest district.
Hey! Okay, back to you, Mr. Doran. What's going on?
Everything good, man. We're here today, at my first meet and greet event for this political campaign. However, not my first event. It's going great. There's a good turnout.
Yes, a full house.
There's a live band that was just on. There's a DJ Wilson on the ones and twos.
Hey, you got iguana soup.
Of course, Bernard. Of course, the iguana soup.
Iguana soup?
Of course.
Okay.
All right. So then,
Okay, you see that? Reporting for BCN TV, and all of a sudden you know the name and everything. BCN TV, Mr. Lyndon Brown. Like, whoa. Before that, it was like, ugh. Brown asking a question during the press briefing. When we gonna get rid of this non-reporter? Ugh. But now election time, hey. Yeah. Vote for, hey, yes. Why? Because the other media know that you're full of shit and we're not going to come to your meet and greet 23 times. There are 23 candidates. I tell you already, or you stop this meet and greet shit. I hate it with a passion. The only one you should go to is the one from Minister Utley, because that one went really good. Roll the clip, Pete.
The people lives been a part of me. And voted O'Malley.
Something that we look forward to do, push the orange economy, push our culture, and give our bands international recognition. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for the Strictly Vibes Band.
Go best friend, your best friend.
But ladies and gentlemen, give a big round of applause for Roy, Roy Renee!
This is the original Booyah. It's up to you, me and you, voting number two. I want to see
what your man that close down, eh?
Close down,
what we tell them, close down, baby.
Close down, baby.
Hold your man that close down, eh?
Close down, eh? It's up to you, me and you, voting number two. Number two, say right. It's up to you, me and you, voting number two.
We back? Oh, sorry. The band was really good. But no, serious. Stop the meet and greets. Okay? Shocks me up. Now, of course, I know for sure that the National Alliance do have good intentions. Like, I know that Darrell York does have a plan when it comes to infrastructure for St. Martin. And I was able to look at some of the plans that he has, and it's looking really good. At least there's one York that knows infrastructure. That was a nice joke. All right. What else? There is also Torchy, ATN Myers. He was seen at the meet and greet of Minister Utley, and he had a very direct message. I don't know to who, but he was like savage. So I had to play it. I was like, listen, I taking this. Take a listen.
Anything else you want to say to the people of St. Martin? And now it's election time. Your nephew, it's giving back right now.
I would like to say one thing. Our family which means the Myers, the Hazels, and the Yorks are like NATO, which means if an attack on one is an attack on all. Thank you.
Thank you, well. Okay, so that was Etienne.
That one was just talking about. Look, you see the question they asked him?
Okie dokie. Now, of course, the election time, it's very important for you to know the voting bureau, the main voting bureau, and the people who's in charge of your sessions dealing with the elections. Of course, we have to once again salute Mr. Jason Rogers for doing it for these 10 years, taking care of the election processes. He went through a lot of elections. Listen, this man went through a lot of elections, you know. Like, it was supposed to just be a 4-to-4-year gig, and he ended up having to organize, I think, 3 or 4 elections. Like, Jesus Christ. But now we have a new voting, main voting bureau person, and that is Natalie Tackling. She did an interview with our favorite Prime Minister, Sylvia Jacobs, during her program, Prime Minister Talks, which only comes on whenever there's election time or whenever she wants to, like, play a reporter for some reason, and then she interviews people. Never got that. Like Prime Minister Talks, that's the name of the show. Which I don't get, because I thought Prime Minister speaks. But apparently she talks. Well, thank God she talks. Imagine if she didn't speak. We would have what we have now. Well, anyway, let's go to getting to know the head of the voting bureau, Natalie Tackling, who has the difficult task of organizing the elections for these 8 political parties that will be contesting the January 11th elections. Let's go to that.
Our guest today, Ms. Natalie Tackling, who is the new chair of the Central Voting Bureau. Natalie, welcome to Prime Minister Talks.
Thank you for having me.
It's always my pleasure. Maybe you could give a little background, because I said you're the new chair, but you were on the Central Voting Bureau before.
I was not.
No, this is your first time.
I was not. Yeah.
Oh, you were in the chair, right? That's what it was.
I wasn't on the board. It's my first election, let's put it that way. And taking over, I guess, from the very capable hands of Jason Rogers, who people are used to seeing and in front of the camera and relating to elections. So for me, really, the first time organizing an election, the first time seeing everything that goes on, you know, behind an election.
Right.
And I'm sure we'll get to that shortly. So I'm excited and for what we're gonna do.
And what is your background? Because I know your background, but for the viewers who may be meeting you for the first time, tell them a little bit about yourself.
Sure. You know, essentially, you know, kind of born and raised here to the extent. And, you know, the passport says something different, but regardless, you know, grew up here, went to, you know, Sister Regina MPC and an attorney by profession. So moved back, you know, as soon as I had finished graduating and to kind of give back and to contribute back to the island, you know, that raised me.
Right. So daughter of the soil, and definitely someone, I think, as a person with a legal background, quite capable of carrying out the laws to ensure we have a free, fair election on St. Martin as usual. How do you feel about the challenge?
We've taken it head on, you know, kind of grabbed the bull by the horns, and I think we've, you know, kind of hit the ground running, so to speak. You know, I had a conversation with your staff saying the election crept up on us. So
even though we knew it was coming,
it's just before you know it, it's we're in full swing, I think, and we're all moving at a rapid pace to make sure everything goes off flawlessly from the outside.
Right. So are there any other projects that you have going outside of the elections?
With the voting bureau, that is.
Yeah.
Okay. No, not me personally. And outside of the election, no. Outside of the election, is pretty much not. You know, we're very much focused on the elections itself. The voting bureau has a very designated and clear role within the electoral ordinance, which is that we carry out the electoral ordinance and everything that has to do with the elections themselves.
Right. And so I could remember in the beginning, you know, people were already clamoring, like, when is this going to happen? When is that going to happen?
Yeah.
Kind of like, take the public back to, you know, all those steps that had to be taken prior to establishing a date.
Absolutely. I think, you know, I think our first contact was back in, you know, June or July of this year. And when everybody was kind of like, what's happening?
Mm-hmm.
And the electoral ordinance itself sets out a timeline, you know, basically of, you know, when dates have to happen.
Right.
So, you know, we calculate back. Essentially, we look at, you know, the sitting term of parliament is decided in the Constitution. It says 4 years. So we know, okay, the 10th of February, 2024. And then we calculate back. So we do all this complicated math and making sure that that all the dates fit, you know, because it's, you know, the election date is 90 days from this date. And then another date is 48 days between 90 days. So it's,
yeah,
it's a lot of
back and forward.
It's a lot of back and forward, yes. And ensuring that you allow sufficient time for all the legal requirements to take place. And I know we had multiple discussions about making all the dates fit and allowing, you know, the legal requirements to be in place.
Yeah, so I was hoping that it could be later in January, you know, with the holidays and everything else.
Yeah.
And with the full term, we had to literally stick with the dates. And I think people are so used to snap elections that also then plays a role. But because it's not a snap election, we know that the 4 years ends on this date, and then everything had to be calculated backwards from there.
Exactly.
Who were some of the stakeholders that you had to, or we, let's say, had to consult? So besides myself and you, who were some of the key stakeholders in the preparation?
I think a lot of people don't realize, you know, who our key stakeholders are, being, you know, the parliament is one that's important to take along into the process. And I think one of the very important ones that maybe a lot of people don't realize is the civil registry. And I myself didn't realize, I think,
how big a role they play
and how much work they put in behind the scenes is incredible. And I have a lot of respect and I'm very grateful for all the work that they do.
Yes.
So, you know, for us, I think those were the most important players. And of course, your ministry, you know, as the ministry in charge.
Yeah, yeah. I must say, civil registry is impressive. They are a well-oiled machine. They know when they have to order everything. They, you know, and legal affairs as well, actually. So both civil registry and legal affairs played a big role in us ensuring we established the dates properly. Of course, the decrees had to be signed off on, etc. And all of that was done in ample time. So I thank you also, even as a first timer, for your contributions in making that a, you know, clean process. It was really, you know, everybody collaborating well. In terms of civil registry's role and, you know, a lot of people panicking, deregistration and or what are this process to, in even the sharing of the voting cards, which are printed and everyone will get theirs. What do you think about the manner in which that is being done?
You just said that they're a well-oiled machine. And what I have noticed, at least for the civil registry, is their willingness to always accommodate and help the public. And even during during endorsement day, I noticed, you know, someone had come in to have their son endorse a list, and it turned out that he had been deregistered. But I saw them kind of like assist and help in that to ensure that that was resolved, so that this young man can you know, could endorse a list, and that also he would be eligible to vote during the election. So, you know, I think with them very much, there's a lot of willingness to help.
Yes. I think we really have to break any myth that this government or Central Voting Bureau or Civil Registry or any of the stakeholders would purposefully remove persons or, you know, remove their ability to vote. So ensuring that you are registered is your responsibility. These situations allow you to see it ahead of time, but you always get the opportunity to re-register once you're on the island. So I know several people have complained to me, and once they heard that once they're on island, those who are off island, once you're back, you can re-register and you will get your voting card. You'll be able to get a voting card to be able to vote come election time. It's very, very important, I think, that we do that. And we will continue to do what we need to do to ensure that everyone who's eligible to vote gets to vote. Because, you know, with so many elections that we've had over the years, waiting 4 years, people, I think, are a little more geared up and ready to go. Yeah,
it's been a while since they got to circle that red.
the dot red. What would you say, before we go to that, we were just talking before the break about the incident of, you know, someone being deregistered and having the ability to re-register. So I just want to reiterate that that is possible. And that if it's, you know, even though the voters registry is closed, that persons who are eligible to vote can re-register. And if the card isn't issued yet, they can get it issued the court can give that order, even on the day of election, to be able to allow you the ability to vote. So don't miss any opportunities, and we will be ensuring that you have more opportunities to get your ID cards, etc., in order as well, because I think that's very important. So what are some of the challenges that you have experienced in your first time as, you know, we can be honest, in your first time in this journey as the head of the people's?
I don't know that I would call them, you know, challenges per se. I think, you know, it's been a learning experience. And as the current board of the Central Voting Bureau, with the exception of two of our members, it's the first time for all of us. And you know, there's not, as we say, a dry book or anything that you can open and say, okay, what are exactly the things I have to do? So you're very much, you know, figuring it out as you're going along and as the ball starts rolling. And previous members have told me, once the ball starts rolling, it starts rolling, and then you're with it. And I didn't understand it until the ball started rolling. And now I get it. And I'm like, oh, yeah, we're in this, and it all makes sense. And I think, you know, as we were saying before, there's so much that goes on behind the scenes that you're not even cognizant of, that I think that once you really get into the process, it all starts to click. And
what are some of those things? What are some of the parts that, say, the general public, you weren't even aware of prior to being part of this organization?
You know, I think even like the little things where it comes down to the work that the Civil Registry puts in and how far in advance they've already started working. And, you know, I went in, I think, 2 weeks ago, and they were already sitting there at, you know, 7 o'clock at night, printing and folding voting cards and checking all the names and dividing them per district. And there's so many manual checks that go into ensuring the accuracy. And, you know, you get a voting card, you don't realize what went into it exactly. So I think those are some examples. And, you know, even now with postulation, all the kind of very particular work that goes into checking all the lists, making sure that they're in order, you know, ensuring that all the timelines, you know, we have a two-page Excel sheet with lots of cells with all these important deadlines of all these things that are supposed to happen legally or be published by a certain date or put out announcements. And it's just a lot of moving parts. And I think that those are the things that we don't realize are even now gearing up for, you know, the designing the ballots, ordering the ballots in time, making sure that we have everything that we need for the booths, for the polling stations.
I think that's a good place to stop and go back, because we just had postulation day and endorsement day. And I know there was some confusion, at least by some one or two of the new parties, as to what, you know, that is. So for public that may not understand, what is postulation or nomination day really? And then what does the law prescribe for the endorsement?
Sure. So essentially, postulation day is the day that all eligible parties, so by eligible, I mean if you have been registered with the Electoral Council as a political party prior to the cutoff, which was October 11th. So if you are a validly registered party, then that is the day that you may submit your candidate list to the Voting Bureau. And then from there, of course, there are lots of requirements that go into what needs to be on these lists. But from that, the law also says that every candidate list has to be endorsed by 1% of the validly cast votes in the previous election. So last election, I think we had something around like 13,300 valid votes that were cast. So which means that this year a party needed to have 134 signatures on their list or as an endorsement. And however, then the law also says that if your party won a seat in the previous election, then you're exempted from that. So we saw the new parties, or, you know, resurrected parties, you know, they, even though they did previously have seats, they didn't have, you know, seats in the last parliamentary election. Mm-hmm. So that's, you know, the endorsement day that we all know. And you know, we saw a lot of supporters outside the government building yesterday with all their shirts and flags. And yeah, like I said, we're very much already in the season.
Yes, for sure. So the nomination or postulation day was on the 22nd. Yep. Each party had to come to Parliament, where you sat with the entire team, handed in. And I must say thank you to DCOM for the great coverage of that. As party leaders, we all got the opportunity to give a few words. And I think the general public who weren't able to be there still could get a feeling of what nomination day is. It's the start of the campaign, actually, because as of the 22nd at midnight, campaigning could start. So it's on. Yeah. Definitely. And then on the 23rd, the opportunity to endorse. So that, I think, went a lot smoother than in previous years because only one list could be endorsed per person.
Like,
yes, but yeah. Sometimes it was a little difficult to check.
Yeah.
And you would always hear like, oh, that person endorsed more than one list. Mm-hmm. But I was really updated that they put
There are systems in place. Yeah. And that's again, you know, my kudos again to the Civil Registry. And apparently I'm the champion of Civil Registry today.
Yep.
But yeah, they had a great system in place where once they put your name and your ID card in, the system will not allow that person to endorse another list. So there were those checks and balances this time. And so just to ensure that, you know, it could only just be
one.
I know there were some rumors going around yesterday that some people endorse more than one list, but I know for a fact that that was not possible.
And that's why I said it, because I wanted to be sure. And if any of the parties, I know all of the parties were able to get the new parties and the resurrected ones, as you call them, were able to get their lists endorsed. So they had at least 134 signatures. Yeah. But say, for instance, that hadn't been the case, would they have gotten an opportunity the following day to do that still?
Yes, they are. And, you know, like I mentioned, there are multiple things that we check the candidate lists for. And one of them is the endorsements. It's also seen as a default in your list if you don't have those. So the law allows that if the person does not have the acquired amount of signatures, that then they're given a second day in which they have the same period between 9 a.m. and 4 p.m. to still try to gather those signatures.
Okay. Well, it wasn't necessary this time around. So that's a blessing indeed. And we'll be able to share further information. I really would like to encourage people to continue to follow DCOM because we're really going to ramp up the communication surrounding elections as we move forward. Welcome back to Prime Minister Talks. We're having a very interesting conversation with the chairlady of the Central Voting Bureau to be updated on all of the tasks, the hard work in collaboration with Civil Registry, especially at this point, that is taking place in preparation for the general elections, parliamentary elections, on January 11th, 2024. So the lists have been handed in, they've been endorsed. What's next for the Central Voting Bureau?
Next, you know, we diligently check all these lists against the legal requirements. And then we allow parties a period of time in which they can cure those, any defaults that are in the list. So that deadline is December 1st. And after that, we have a public meeting in which we officially validate the list for the upcoming election.
That they're valid.
Correct. So at that moment, the decision is made or not. So, you know, I had a question recently where it was like after the endorsement saying, oh, so now the parties can contest. And I was like, well, no, they can contest once we have actually, you know, kind of decreed that they're valid.
Right.
So that's next. And then, of course, after that, you know, what I think maybe some people might find interesting is, you know, we do have a public meeting again where parties get to choose their colors and their numbers. And when I say the colors and the numbers, of course, they have the colors they campaign with, but these colors are the colors that are on the ballot itself, along with the number in which they end up on the ballot.
And when you say public meeting, it's in a televised.
Correct. Yeah. So it's open to the public. The public is welcome to come. The parties are welcome to come. And it will be televised through the government page.
Okay. Great. So we can all look forward to that. And that will happen after the 1st of December.
Correct.
So we'll get more announcements and look forward to that from the Central Voting Bureau. And on election day itself, what are some of the main tasks that the main Central Voting Bureau will be executing?
It starts at least for the chair quite early in the morning. I had this conversation with the members. They were like, oh, we start at 8. I was like, well, I start at 5, you know, because that's when, you know, everybody leaves the government building with all the ballots and they're handed over sealed to the different polling stations. And then there's actually a police escort to ensure that there's no tampering with the ballots and the like. So the day starts very early there. And then of course, as Voting Bureau, we are ensuring that we're visiting all the polling stations to ensure that everything is in place. Of course, we do an inspection the night before, but during the day, you're also going by to make sure that everything is going according to plan, that there are no incidents, and we continue to monitor the process throughout the day.
Nice. I know from previous elections, we do see that the governor also comes around, et cetera, and it's good. And people have been asking about election observers. Are you in contact with any?
So far, of course, we welcome any election observers. I think that we have reached out to some through the Civil Registry and previous contacts. So we're waiting to hear back to see if any come. And of course, but that's part part of the transparency in our electoral process is that we facilitate and welcome any international observers into our process.
Good. That's good to know because, you know, that's how we are here. We trust the outsider sometimes more than, but I must say in what I've experienced in the last election and in this one, we're very, very professional as government's organization in ensuring that everything is done meticulously. In fact, I told Kathy of Civil Registry to ensure that the training takes place, that the same thing is happening at all polling stations, because that usually creates confusion. And that was allowed there. That isn't allowed there. You know, really go through the guidelines and so on and what's allowed, what's not allowed, so that we can all feel free to come out and cast our votes. So you're new. And one thing I like about having some younger blood coming into not just government, but things like the Maine Voting Bureau, Central Voting Bureau, is what kind of improvements would you like to see just off the bat? Like things that you see, okay, we could do this differently next time.
Yeah. I mean, besides looking at the process itself, I think maybe just at the organization, and one of the ones that I would like to champion is there's confusion all the time between what the Electoral Council does and what the Central Voting Bureau does. And I think we would maybe be served by merging both bodies. And
yes,
I think there would be so many beautiful things that the Central Voting Bureau could do with more budget. And because, you know, we really only kick in and get a budget just purely for the elections. And, you know, I keep getting asked, where's your office? Where's your website? And I'm like, well,
we don't have any of that.
And, you know, but I do think that the Voting Bureau in that sense, in that build, can be used as a beautiful educational platform for the St. Martin public, you know, to educate people about the electoral process, to go out into the schools, to go out into the different districts and outside of election times, that there's just an independent source for everything to do with the electoral process.
Yeah.
And I think that could be a really great thing. And that would be an improvement that I would love to see. And of course, then we, as a government, as a parliament, those decisions need to be made of, do we want to task this body with different tasks? You know, we keep getting a lot of advice requests.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I constantly have to tell you I'm not an advisory body and the law doesn't allow me to. But, you know, I think, again, with sufficient funding and manpower, mm-hmm. and that you could make, you know, the entity do a bit more.
Right.
So I think that those are certainly improvements.
But it's and definitely where the advice comes in is as a stakeholder, right. You know, when the legislation changes, you're the ones that have to really execute it. So with all of the changes that are being proposed, the Raad van Advies, the Council of Advice, is asking, what does the Maine Voting Bureau say about it? So, you know, as a good administrator, I pass that information on. And with the recent change of removal of the curtains, we did also get your feedback as a Central Voting Bureau, and it was approved. So hopefully we'll go into force.
It is, right? I saw the end of December.
Yes. So hopefully we'll go into force in time. And it's another attempt to create a more transparent process. Of course, you still have your stemgeheim, your what do you call that in English? Voters secrecy. And, you know, you just keep your ballot, you know, in front of you. And then no one from the back should be able to tell. And furthermore, the members of the polling station are trained, they're impartial, they do all their voting before anyone comes in, and they're not allowed to show any preference to anyone. So it's really, I think, it should be an improvement, and I hope that we're all able to go through it smoothly, because you know how we are with change.
Yes.
Do you have anything further on that to say? And then any closing words to the people of St. Martin regarding preparations for elections?
When it comes to, you know, I think the removal of the curtain, and of course, we're seeing that as a first step, you know, and I think as a voting bureau, we certainly applaud, you know, these measures taken by government, and we remain as an active stakeholder as a part of that. And what I would really, I think, like to encourage people at least is to really go out and vote on January 11th. And, you know, it is our democratic right, and people around the world have fought for centuries to have that right and to be able to contribute. So I think it's super important that everybody goes out, educates themselves, choose the right candidates, think about what you want to see in this country, and go and cast your vote.
URSM number 5. Yeah. Time to vote. It's time for change, come on, let's all go. Time to vote for somebody, yo. Who gon' fight for you? Who gon' stand up and defend and represent you? Full of experience with the law, she ready to go. Full of experience, she's ready to go. Ready to fight for this country, make it better for we. So let us all come together and give her a seat. She's gonna work for us all.
Parliament right here would love nothing better than to say, let's allocate 10 million guilders towards helping our issues in social needs and so on. But how are we to do that when we have all of these conditions of, well, you can't get more liquidity, you need to cut, you need to do this. We, many of us feel like we're in a position where we can't fully extend our ability to legislate.
But my decision is to stay where I'm at. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, the way that MP Rolando Bryson leads, he allows me to work. He gives me that freedom to work. It's not always a full call of pressure or do this, do that, don't do this, you know, and that's part of the reason that I'm able to produce.
Any of the difficulties that this government faces today, I didn't sit down, do nothing, and have my staff write press releases. No, I got up and asked myself from opposition benches, what can I do? So I read my constitution, the one I swore to uphold, which gives us the rights to bring laws, to bring amendments, interpolation rights, inquiry rights. So we asked ourselves the questions at the time, what have we done, regardless of...
He has represented this country qua what is expected of a parliamentarian professionally, and I can align myself with that.
The people always been a part of me, and voted over Ali.
Something that we look forward to do.
Imagine we probably go far, and we know, search for a sign of a change, a Chino. You know it got days when you feel like a zero. I woke up this morning, but feel like Mark Mingo. Tomorrow be a better day. Respect is the key, education gon' matter, so don't you try to run away. So imagine the place where the food is good, the people is good, the music is good. We living like we on a rose. They're trying to take us down, but I'm thinking, could they really do? Misunderstood. Oh Lord, help us protect ourselves. Help us look in ourselves. We're searching for what they call the fire that's in ourselves. I just want to see the best for my motherland. I just want the whole world here to understand that we came from the bottom of the sewer. Now we heading way up, high up, unto Wonderland. Opportunity is yours, so make it happen. Take an action.
Some of them even say, is the guns on Monkoko? So they won't let me play, and they blaming polio. Who they think they could fool? All we know they better do fast. Polio or no polio, man we won, we must.
Mama, when they hear, they go get the carnival.
Oh, oh, all masqueraders on here.
Well, they didn't care if it was official.
But they start turning peace on the street.
And they start to jump around.
Yeah.
And they start to tumble down.
Yeah.
And they fall down on the ground.
Yeah.
Yes, they see how they came.
Yeah. But what was so comical in the midst of a canal?
Rain comes and wash out mass in May.
Do they think they could fool? All we know they better do fast. Polio or no polio, man we won, we must.
Mama, when they hear, they go get the carnival.
Oi, oi, all masquerade.
Qu'est-ce que tu fais là? Qu'est-ce que tu fais là?
But sorry, no, sir. They got this game tonight, and I can't miss it. Me and my boy, we gotta watch the game, you know. So I'm bringing this in. You check? All right, let me watch your leg.
Sir, sorry. Why so difficult? Look, I'm watching TV here on my phone with the Tell TV Plus app. You really gotta upgrade.
Okay, so Miss, tell me about the Tell TV Plus. I hear about this.
Okay, so once you apply for Tell TV Plus,
okay,
you can enjoy it anytime on the go.
Anytime.
On the go? On the go. You simply download the app, log into your account at any time, sit back and enjoy. You will never have to miss your match.
Yo, bus driver, take me back to tell him now, please.
All right, also, the general pension age. You wrote us there was an increase that is going to happen. Minister Omar Utley explains.
I am Minister Omar Utley, and I am extremely elated that we are here today, on this day, signing the increase of the AOWA Aweiwei pension, the elderly, orphanage, and widow pension. The increase is finally becoming a reality. We received the document and approval from His Excellency on November 15th, and I am here today to share this momentous moment with you. It has been a long time coming, and I'm happy to say that that time has arrived. Seniors will see this benefit in their bank account. The increase to their pension will be noticed at the end of December. The reason we are doing at the end of December, pension is actually prepaid. So in November, you will receive what is called the 13th month, because your payment in November actually represents the December payment. And therefore, to avoid taxation with a large lump sum, we have decided that you, the seniors of St. Martin, will receive this retroactive increase in December, specifically December 28th or 29th. The funds, the increase will be in your account. Thank you.
They also had a job fair that was recently organized. I know you're wondering if a lot of people went. Yes, and a lot of people was apparently hired on the spot. So let's go to that.
I am Minister Omar Utley, your Minister of Public Health, Social Development and Labor. And I would like to say I'm extremely elated for the success of this national job fair hosted by the NES and Division of Labor Affairs. This is one of the biggest job fairs ever held. It's a public-private partnership whereby many companies submitted their vacancies through the Ministry of VSR. We encourage everyone to continue, remain vigilant, remain focused and looking for any announcements that may come in the future. But for right now, I'm extremely happy with the progress and turnout of this job fair. Thank you.
We were here at the Bel Air doing the National Employment Service Center National Job Fair. Yesterday basically was the entrepreneurship event. Both of these collaborations are with the St. Martin Chamber of Commerce and Industry, and Ms. Brandon was present as well yesterday. The turnout on both days is phenomenal. The job fair turnout was phenomenal, beyond expectation. Many persons received jobs on the spot. For persons that were unable to make it to the National Job Fair, we encourage you to visit the National Employment Service Center at the Government Administration Building on the ground floor, the VSR section, Division Labor Affairs and Social Services. We promise and we are committed to continue with this, to offer persons job, to make business engagements, and also to equip persons to land that job and keep that job. That's what this is about, and we're very proud of everyone that took part in it. And I would like to thank the businesses as well. Thank you very much.
First of all, a big props to the NES for organizing it the way they have done. We are very impressed with the volume of candidates, the preparation that they have, the way they have organized it. So far, we're halfway today. We already have a good number of candidates that have been selected for second interviews. And so far, we also have a good amount of candidates that have already been hired on the spot because either they have the qualifications or the experiences that we're looking for here.
Hi, I'm Diudis. I'm here at the job fair today that's happening, and I must say that this has been an exciting experience for me. I came and I applied to two companies, the Hilton, the port, oh, three, and also the airport. Great companies to work at. The people are very friendly and they're giving out a lot of opportunities here, so I'm happy that I made the decision to come today.
Okay, welcome to the Late Night Show. We have a good one for you. Sit back, relax, and let's go.
Calm down. Enjoy, guys. Happy holidays.
Thank you very much, Minister. I'm Riggs. And we have officially welcomed you into the holiday season with the lighting of football. Please take note that the members of the round notice that you are welcome to join the vendors for a treat. They are all to the public. And repeat, please enjoy all the treats you can because they are all free to the public.
That is it for the Late Night Show. Thank you so much for watching. Until tomorrow, do have a safe and pleasant one. And remember, St. Martin continues to be not a real place. I don't care what nobody say. Sue me. Bring me to court.